Hey folks, Dr. Mike here for Renaissance Periodization. Today's topic is reducing hunger while dieting for fat loss. Good God, is this an important lecture for anyone who's ever lost fat and realized that being hungry stinks. And hunger is honestly one of the reasons many people fail to meet their goals in fat loss, because good God, you know, when you're real deep into a fat loss diet and burritos and potato chips and brownies, and can you guys tell I'm dieting? JK, I'm actually not dieting that hard quite yet. So all those things sound fine, but when you get really crazy into a diet, they sound crazy good, and it makes dieting harder if you're hungry all the time. Hunger interferes with sleep, all this other bad stuff. It stresses you out. We want to reduce it as much as possible. Imagine a fat loss diet process, which you complete, and upon reflection, you never really got super hungry. I mean, holy crap, is that a huge victory. 8, hunger reduction strategies that I'm personally aware of and we have published in our books at Renaissance Periodization. The Renaissance Diet 2.0 book, by the way, is the one you want to buy if you want to learn a lot more about these and how to apply them. Here they are. I'm going to list them out, and as I list them, I'm going to describe them. Later, I'll let you know when to use them, because there's a good time and not so great time. And then lastly, we'll talk about one meal that we can make that has more or less very similar macros, but is a bit of a different approach as far as food selection that integrates most of these strategies. One meal is a real anti-hunger meal that'll really fill you up, keep you full longer. One meal is the opposite trend, where you just hate food, but you still have to eat a ton, a mass gaining meal that uses the opposite of pretty much all these strategies. So first is low calorie density. A lot of folks are interested in saying, okay, I like cheeseburgers. How can I integrate them into my diet? Well, the answer is macros. If it fits your macros, then it's good to go. The problem is you eat half a cheeseburger, and because it's so dense in calories, the eating experience is quickly over. You're still pretty hungry and you're done. So you're just miserable, but you don't have any more calories. If you eat things like green veggies, like fruits, like oats, like chicken breast and fish type of proteins, there is a lot of calories in a huge, or sorry, not so many calories, in a huge volume of food. And after eating all that, you're really full, but for the calories you need to hit that meal. So low calorie density is absolutely a great idea, which is why most junk foods are more or less ruled out for most people when they're really pushing the pace in fat loss dieting, because almost one of the quintessential unifying descriptions of junk food sort of underneath it all is that the junk food has a high calorie density almost every time. Second, higher protein. This tends to top off at just north of a gram per pound per day, but up to a gram per pound and probably a little bit over, the more protein you eat, generally speaking, the more you are satiated, which is really good. So if you're on a low protein diet, which I know some of you folks have friends and family that do fad diets and regular fitness stuff, and they're trying to lose fat and they're eating very little protein, you're like, you know, this could be a lot easier for you if you ate more protein, and that's absolutely correct. And in fact, eating protein at every major meal tends to curb hunger than eating a lot of it at some points and no protein at other points. Number 3, not eating when not hungry, okay? The last thing you want to do is the following. Let's say you're a person like myself who isn't super hungry in the mornings but gets pretty hungry in the evenings. The last thing you want to do is shovel food into your mouth in the morning when you hate it. And then in the evening, you got these little bitty portions of food you finish and you're done. You're like, you start eating your own hand. If you notice that at some points of the day you are predictably not as hungry, don't eat a ton of food. Either redistribute your meals and macros, or even if you've made the meals already, just save some of that food for later. If you get not so hungry during breakfast but pretty hungry during lunch, eat a smaller breakfast or eat half the breakfast you normally would. Save the rest or portion the macros the rest towards lunch. And then when you're predictably hungry at lunch, you're going to have a big meal and you're just never going to be hungry. If you're stuffing yourself at any one part of the day and then ravenous at another part, it's like you have too much here, not enough there. All you need to do is move it in and then everything is level. You got two victories. You're never uncomfortable from eating too much and you're never hungry, which is a really, really great thing. This one takes a little bit of, a few weeks at least, maybe a few days of feeling out your body to see when you're hungriest and when not. Remember, nutrient timing, as long as you get multiple high protein meals per day, is not really a big deal on fat loss results. So it's okay to eat a little bit more in the evening, a little bit more in the morning, more midday, whenever you tend to find yourself hungrier, and less at the times when you're not super hungry. So even balls deep into a fat loss phase, my first meal of the day is usually a protein shake, like casein or casein whey mix, because I look at food and I'm like, ugh, I have to have protein. So I have the shake. And then like 3 hours later, 4 hours later, I'm like, oh yeah, I could eat some food. And by then I just go train and then come back and eat, so on and so forth. Next, higher fiber. Fiber tends to attract water to itself. It tends to expand the stomach and the small intestines, and that tends to give a signal of fullness. So if you're eating high fiber foods, it's really good. Also, fiber has between very few and no calories at all. So while you're getting super full, the calorie density equation is really boosted by fiber. So it has really two benefits in that regard, and that's really cool. Fiber predictably lowers hunger. How many stalks of broccoli can you eat until you don't want to eat broccoli anymore? Yeah, I don't know, one or something like that. Tons of fiber, very low calorie density, checks a lot of the boxes. Next, no liquid calories. Okay, one of the easiest way to get people, regular folks that are overweight, to lose weight is to tell them no more fruit juices, no more milkshakes, and no more sodas. Switch to diet sodas. And as soon as they do that, there's 800 calories just drop out of their diet. And they're no hungrier because, generally speaking, liquid calories are the opposite of the extreme. They're an easy way to get tons of calories in without, your hunger falling off much. So actually, if you're trying to tell someone to gain mass and they're like, I can't eat any more physical food, you say, okay, try some orange juice with your meals of chicken and rice. And all of a sudden, it's 300 grams extra carbs through the whole day. And they're like, I actually feel quite good and I'm not super stuffed. So this is the opposite of what you want. It's crazy to see people really in the throes of a diet, really, really complaining about hunger. And they're still drinking orange juice or they're having post-workout shakes. Just have a post-workout meal. Get rid of the shake. It's going to make things a lot easier. Another one, a bit more tentative, but there's some research to support this, is to drink a little bit of fluid before you start eating a meal, and especially at restaurant meals and stuff that are super tasty. If you eat a bit slower, there may be an advantage to curbing hunger just a little bit better with that meal, or not having that insane ability to pile food on before your brain even registers you're eating. So if you eat a little slowly, so basically here's how it is. You sit down at a restaurant with your friends and you're at the end of a fat loss diet. You're like, it's okay. I know what to order on the menu, but God damn it, I'm ravenous. And you know, the waitress brings like a little pan pizza for someone. And you're like, oh my God, it smells so good. It looks so good. Ah, this is tough. Get a diet soda of some kind, or just like I like to get, what's it called, like club soda or whatever, just the, the bubble shit, right? And you get that and you just down it, okay? Not, you don't have to go super fast, but, you know, over the course of 2 or 3 minutes, down the whole thing, ask for another one. And then when your meal comes, because already then you're kind of full, ask for some more. And then when your meal comes, eat your meal slowly, talk to your friends, scroll on your phone, do whatever it is you do. That actually tends to give you an experience that by the time you're done eating your meal, you tend to feel fuller than if you just completely just warp the meal right into your face. You're going to be sitting around much more likely to still be hungry. So that's a strategy that doesn't work all the time, not for all people. Certainly something to consider. Next is a higher intake of caffeine than what you're used to. So if you're used to none, introducing caffeine tends to really, really squash the appetite quite well. If you used to 300 mg of caffeine per day, slowly work up to 350, 400, 400, 450, 500, and so on and so forth. And as long as you're staying within the safe range, which is like 700 to 1,000 mg per day, as long as your sleep isn't crazy affected, caffeine does work. So if you're really struggling with hunger, especially early to midday when caffeine wouldn't interfere with your nightly sleep, it's probably a good idea to have some caffeine. It really does work. And most of the fat burners on the market work exactly and only through this mechanism. Lastly, and this one is massive. This is one of those best for last ones. It really is. Reduce or eliminate high palatability foods. High palatability foods is a real science-y ass way of saying the food tastes really fucking good and you just want to keep eating it, right? What was a huge tagline for decades for potato chips? Bet you can't eat just one. That's fucking hard. Them shits taste good. And as soon as you have one potato chip, you just want another one. For me, my ultimate heel is the salt and vinegar potato chips. This might as well be made of crack cocaine to your boy, because I'm on that shit like white on rice. I can eat a whole fucking bag without the assistance of marijuana. And if I get doped up a little bit, who knows how many bags I'm gonna eat? I don't, because I'm too high to fucking count the bags. But tasty food has this effect, especially when you're deep into a fat loss diet, of just making you want to eat more of it, not less. I get one potato chip, I want 10. If I have zero, I want 5, right? So if I'm getting into a place with my diet, or if you're getting into a place with your diet where you're really starting to be hungry, start eating blander, more boring foods that fill you up and check all these other boxes. And all of a sudden, people are like, oh man, you're pretty starving right now. You're like, yep, I'm starving. And they're like, bet you're excited for your next meal. And you're like, I don't know, am I bland chicken and broccoli and veggies and brown rice? Sure. I mean, it's food. And then if you're starving enough, even that tastes good, but it doesn't taste addictive good. And after you finish that meal, you're like, oh, I'm good for a couple hours, right? Whereas if you finish whatever, if we really fuck this up, half a slice of pizza and a can of orange juice or something, you're going to be hungry immediately after finishing it, having met the same calories. So really counterintuitive, because when the time comes, when your fat loss diet is really, really torching you, you're going to want, instinctively desire, the most high palatable foods. I mean, look, I've done this before. Towards the end of a really insane diet, I make lists of foods I'm going to eat as soon as the diet is over, or I'm going to introduce slowly, like, oh, this one pizza place. Oh my God, this one pasta place. Okay, am I Italian? I just didn't know. So that kind of stuff can be really tempting, but if you move away from it, then, you know, you don't have as big of a risk of going overboard, and you're actually quite satisfied. I'm going to make a really terrible, awkward analogy here. You guys ever seen that stupid-ass movie back from the early 2000s? I think it's like 40 Days and 40 Nights. It's with Josh Hartnett. He was so dreamy. Probably is still. I haven't looked into it in a while. But it's like a movie about, like, he's like stopped J and the D for like 40 days straight, which I think is a really stupid idea, probably make most people criminally insane. But like, if you decide to go, you know, be abstinent, which in a sense, fat loss dieting is like partial abstinence from food. If you're abstinent from jerking off, do you watch as much porn as possible? No, because as soon as you turn on porn, you're like, holy shit, ew, here I go. Abstinence over. If you just avoid the shit, then it makes it way easier. And someone's like, oh, I bet you can't wait to jerk off. You're like, yeah, I guess, think about it. But normally I just don't see anything in my natural environment, have no friends, I stare at a wall all day. No big deal, right? Same idea for eating, or similar. If you just not introduce yourself to really super tasty foods, it's going to make the thing much easier than otherwise. How's that for the analogy? I hope many of you will comment for the old algorithm about, I wonder what kind of porn... I don't know. I'm not going to give you any more fuel for this shit. Conversation over, damn it. All right. When do we use these anti-hunger strategy? Because you could say as soon as the diet starts, we use them all. Well, hold on a second. Diets follow a pretty distinct pattern, a pretty predictable pattern. Generally speaking, as soon as you start, if you're dieting properly, fat loss dieting properly, which means you introduce certain macros that'll be at a deficit, and as soon as your body adjusts several weeks later, you reduce them and then adjusts and you reduce them and then it dies over. Okay, so we're sequential reduction of macros. When you start your fat loss diet, you're generally not super hungry at the start of the diet because you were just maintaining or massing before. The macros are plentiful. So the hunger gets worse as the diet progresses and you're most hungry at the tail end of the diet or just after the diet is over. Pretty predictable. Almost all cases it happens like this. So when you just start the diet, don't use a whole lot of anti-hunger strategies. Eat relatively normally without mind to a whole lot of these and get the easy fat loss while you can. I mean, look, if you can eat, you know, relatively normal foods, even some tasty ones, and just like lose a pound or two a week, fuck, do it. Because also you can save the anti-hunger strategies for later for when they're really, really necessary. Save your big weapons for when you need them as your hunger climbs through the diet and you notice like, okay, the last 2 days, I was really hungry and it's starting to affect my sleep. Let's turn a couple of these dials on one of these 8 anti-hunger strategies a little up or all the way up, and then we'll get that effect. So you begin to use a few more of them or use any one of them more, and then you get more and more of an effect. And then when the fat loss phase is over, I would highly recommend, so that you don't rebound and turn into a gigantic fat piece of shit like me, you don't want to just, as soon as the diet is over, go to the all-you-can-eat pizza buffet and then ice cream buffet, I don't even know if that's a thing, and then, you know, rocket ship to fattest man of all time. What you want to do is continue to use the anti-hunger strategies, but boost your macros to high maintenance or massing phase levels. Because there's only so many weeks you're going to be able to eat quote-unquote clean food or anti-hunger food, at maintenance or massing macros until you're like, fuck this, I don't want to eat anymore. And then as you get really full over days and weeks, usually just 1 to 2 weeks later, you're going to be like, man, I'm not craving as much as I used to be. These meals are really filling me up. As a matter of fact, it's tough for me to get to my meals. Then you turn the dial a little bit down on the anti-hunger stuff. Then you start doing the situation where like, okay, you were eating really low density foods. Now you can't stuff that much food in. You turn it down a notch to moderate density foods. Not cheeseburgers quite yet, but some tastier stuff that has a few more calories in it. And then you're back to normal. And that entire time, you essentially reintroduce yourself back into normal eating and everything is good. that's it. It's almost a self-solving problem. It does take a ton of diligence because remember, instinctually, what do you want to do after the diet? End of the diet's actually a gnarly time. You're really prone to fat gain. And psychologically, you're free. You're good to go. Like at least during the diet, you're like, I'm not going to cheat myself. God damn it. So I'm going to do this diet. I'm not going to cheat. After the diet, diet's over. No one's counting. Body really shows over. All the pictures have been taken. Who cares? And you're in a position where psychologically you're ready to eat everything. So that trifecta really can really screw you over. So you have to be diligent and forward thinking and say, no, I'm going to do this right. A few cheat meals here and there is okay, but make sure most of your intake is still relatively anti-hunger and then only weave it away, weave it down as your body demonstrates and your mind demonstrates to you over days and weeks that actually, no, I'm having trouble eating all this shit. And in order for me to actually meet my macros, I have to dial down the anti-hunger stuff. So as an example, because at this point, look, I gave you a lot of theory and shit like that, but you might be like, okay, what is this an example of, right? So here we go. Low hunger meal. Let's say 40 grams of protein, okay? And you get that 40 grams of protein from chicken thighs, okay? Actually, 30 grams of protein because you have lowered your protein a little bit, from the like 1.25 grams per pound, you've actually lowered it to 1 gram per pound because you're massing and you're having trouble eating. 30 grams of protein from chicken thighs, which means more fat, and chicken thighs are so fucking tasty. White rice with some teriyaki sauce. Oh my God, we could make this go down, no problem. A bit of cilantro with half a tomato, deliciousness. Okay, no crazy high volume veggies or anything. 8 ounces of fruit juice with that meal. You eat it right after a cardio session is over or a session of activity is over, and you eat it over the course of 10 minutes because boom, you want to, as soon as a tasty meal is in front of you and you're having trouble gaining mass, you want that meal, you want to get ahead of the pace. It's kind of like a race. Don't choke to death, but you want to eat at a diligent pace. You guys know how it is when you're massing and you're not hungry. If you slow down on a meal, the shit catches up with you and then you're not finishing it at all. On the other hand, similar meal, similar macros, on a high hunger situation at the end of a fat loss diet, 40 grams of protein, notice the more protein, but with chicken breast this time, look, how many people get excited about chicken breast versus chicken thighs? It's not even close. Brown rice flavored with plain salt. At this point, you're feeling sorry for yourself, but you're sure as hell not super excited to eat this. Tons of green veggies, half the plate's green veggies, tons of volume, excellent amount of fiber, so on and so forth. 6 ounces of water right before the meal, 8 ounces of coffee with the meal. So as you finish your meal, the caffeine hits the blood and it further blunts your hunger. So you can 3 or 4 hours later, you're still not hungry. And after cardio is over, you go shower, you go shave, do whatever. 30 minutes later after cardio is over, because after cardio, sometimes, including after training, but especially after cardio, you tend to have the situation where you're not very hungry. Like physical activity directly increases your fight or flight hormone secretion, and that usually those are anti-hunger hormones. So you buy yourself 30 minutes of anti-hunger time for free and only eat after you shave and shower so that you can, you know, have that same amount of anti-hunger time and 30 minutes extra through the day. And you might eat this meal over the course of 20 minutes instead of 10, really taking your time to eat the meal so that you get nice and satiated. Just as an example, folks, feel free to apply this yourself. Comment, like, subscribe, YouTube, TikTok, Instagram. I have no idea where I am. It's all social media to me. See you next time.